down.
And welcome to chapel. My name is Hannah Stutzman. I am the student director of the Friesen Center, and this week is service emphasis week. So we're super excited about what we have planned for chapel this week and what we have in the weeks to come. So I'm going to go ahead and introduce our speaker right now, and then I'll pray and we'll go ahead and get started. So Father Rick Leone has been a priest in the Anglican tradition for over 25 years. In addition, he has been a licensed clinical social worker for over 25 years, as well as a master's addiction counselor and rapid resolution practitioner. Father Rick has also been trained in ASSIST, which is applied suicide intervention skills training, and QPR, which is question, persuade, and refer suicide prevention programs. He has worked in areas of addiction, hospice, mental health, and grief work. Father Rick has taught at IPFW, Ivy Tech, and was a faculty member at Huntington University. He continues to serve on the Community Advisory Board for the Huntington University Social Work Department. He is currently the Senior Director of Pastoral Ministry and Mental Health at the Fort Wayne Rescue Mission, where he serves the homeless, the addicted, and the mentally ill. He pastors Risen Savior Church in Huntington. Risen Savior Church is committed to the celebration of ethnic and racial diversity. The church is active in the recovery community. Risen Savior is unique in that the church flows in the evangelical, charismatic, Pentecostal, and sacramental and liturgical streams. Father Rick has been married to Diane for 31 years, and together they have 5 children.
All right, could you guys stand and worship with us? I'll pray to get us started. God, thank you so much for this day. Thank you that we get to gather together and worship you, worship your name. We pray that we'll be more attuned to your presence and your working around us through our time worshiping you. Amen.
God is an awesome God. He reigns from heaven above with wisdom, power, and love. Our God is an awesome God, and our God is an awesome God. He reigns from heaven above with wisdom, power, and love. Our God is an awesome God, and our God is an awesome God. He reigns from heaven above. The power and love, our God is an awesome God. 'Cause our God is an awesome God. He reigns from heaven above with wisdom. The power and love, our God is an awesome God. And our God is an awesome God. He reigns from heaven. Our God is an awesome God, and our God is an awesome God. He reigns from heaven above with wisdom, power. Of our God is an awesome God. Our God is an awesome God. He reigns from heaven. God, he reigns from heaven above with wisdom, power of our God is an awesome God. Jehovah, Most High God. You are the Most High. You are the Most High God, Jehovah Jireh.
To the end.
I'm holding nothing back. Holding nothing back. All to Jesus. All to Jesus now. All to Jesus now. I'm holding nothing back. Holding nothing back. I surrender. I surrender. I surrender. Arms wide open, pouring out my life, gracefully broken. Sing that again. Here I am, God, arms wide open. Hearts will be open to hear what you have to say to us. Through Father Rick, I pray that you would bless him and give him the words to speak. We pray all these things in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit, now and forever. Amen.
Am I on? Yep. Can y'all hear me? Amen. Good morning. Good morning. Oh, that's kind of weak. Let's try that again. Good morning.
Good morning.
It's a joy and an honor for me this morning to be with you as you celebrate Service Week. HU has a special place in my heart, having taught here, having served on the Community Advisory Board, having friends that teach here, parishioners that go here, as well as my oldest daughter graduating from here a few years ago, and my baby, Grace, Hi, sweetie. Isn't she cute? I didn't tell I wasn't going to embarrass her today, so. A few years ago, my family and I, we worshiped at a church on the south side of Chicago. It's an African-American church. And it was there that I really learned how to praise and to worship God in freedom and in joy, and where I really learned how to preach the good news of the gospel of Jesus. And I came to really appreciate how the interaction between the preacher, the priest, and the congregation. So I want to invite you all today to respond to what I'm saying. Let out some amens and hallelujahs. Praise God as we gather together this morning, as we celebrate God, as we celebrate the Lord Jesus Christ. I want you to be free to do that this morning. Amen. Oh, that was kind of weak. Amen. That's better. God is good and all the time. Amen. You all heard my bio, but I want to tell you a little bit more about who I am, the most important part of who I am. And that most important part of who I am is that I love Jesus, and I am a follower of the Lord Jesus. I am a grateful believer in the Lord Jesus Christ. That's the most important part of who I am. And the best and the greatest decision I ever made in my life was to give my life and my heart to Jesus Christ. The second thing was to marry my wife. But the first thing was to give my life and my heart to Jesus. And I was saved at the age of 18. I was led to Jesus by a Roman Catholic priest who led me into a relationship with Jesus and prayed with me for the outpouring of the Holy Spirit in my life. And so nothing has been the same since I was 18. So the last 40 years, I won't tell you how old I am, but I'll just tell you, for the last 40 years, I have served Jesus and his church in a variety of ministries and professionally as a social worker and as a licensed addictions counselor. When I think of service, and I think of the greatest person who ever served, I think of Jesus. He is the greatest servant that we could ever acknowledge and follow. And I want to read for you now a couple of verses from Matthew 20. When the 10 heard about, this was the story about Zebedee and the boys. And Zebedee's mom is trying to get the boys positioned in a way that they are in a good place, right? She wants to make sure that her boys have places of authority and have a good position in this new kingdom that Jesus is going to be establishing. So this is what happens. She talks to Jesus, and then the 10 hear about it, the 12 hear about this, and then they're not real happy about these guys. So here's what happens. So when the 10 heard about this, they were indignant with the two brothers. Jesus called them together and said, "You know that the rulers of the Gentiles lord it over them, and their high officials exercise authority over them. Not so with you. Instead, whoever wants to become great among you must be your servant, and whoever wants to be first must be your slave, just as the Son of Man did not come to be served, but to serve, and to give his life as a ransom for many." And then also we read in Philippians chapter 2, it says this: "Who, being in the very nature God, did not consider equality with God something to be used to his own advantage. Rather, he made himself nothing by taking the very nature of a servant, being made in human likeness, and being found in appearance as a man. He humbled himself by becoming obedient to death, even death on a cross." Amen? And as we look at these passages, my brothers and sisters, we see Jesus, God's one and only Son, laying aside his glory to serve a broken, hurting, fallen humanity, giving his life as a ransom for you and I. His greatest expression of servanthood was his death on the cross, fulfilling the will of his Father. But what do we mean by this word servant? Here's what comes to mind. A person who performs duties for others. A devoted and helpful follower or supporter. And the first part of that word, servant, S-E-R-V, comes from the Latin where the meaning is slave. And this is how Jesus described himself as we read in Matthew 20, 28. Jesus, my brothers and sisters, modeled servanthood when he came to dwell among us. He is the perfect servant. He became a servant when he obeyed God's will, as we heard in the reading from Philippians. And in John 13, 12 to 15, he demonstrated his servanthood when he washed the feet of his disciples and set the example of how his followers were to serve others. Amen? And when he had finished washing their feet, he put on his clothes and returned to his place. Do you understand what I have done for you? He asked them. You call me teacher and Lord, and rightly so, for that is what I am. Now that I, your Lord and teacher, have washed your feet, you also should wash one another's feet. I have set an example that you should do as I have done for you. Henry Nouwen wrote this, beautiful, powerful. He said, our God is a servant God. It is difficult for us to comprehend that we are liberated by someone who became powerless, that we are being strengthened by someone who became weak, that we find hope in someone who divested himself of all distinctions, that we find a leader in someone who became a servant. Amen. Jesus showed humanity. I want you all to hear me on this morning, brothers and sisters. Jesus showed humanity that true power resides in humble acts of service. Let me say that again. I want you all to hear that now. Jesus showed humanity that true power resides in humble acts of service. Say amen. Y'all need to hear that this morning, brothers and sisters. Now, Jesus wasn't soft on sin, but he understood sinners. And he demonstrated love and kindness and compassion in the ways he interacted with the social outcasts of his day, prostitutes and tax collectors, and the list goes on. And throughout his earthly ministry, he was totally involved in serving other people. The entire Gospel of St. Mark presents Jesus as the perfect servant. And you know, hundreds of years before Jesus was born, the prophet Isaiah wrote in no uncertain terms that the Messiah would be a servant. Many Old Testament prophecies predicted that the Messiah would come as a great prophet, a perfect king, and a mighty Lord, a perfect priest. But Isaiah, brothers and sisters, emphasized that the Messiah would come as a humble servant. Now listen to these verses from Isaiah 42. It's the first of the four servant songs that introduce us to the servant of the Lord. Here is my servant, whom I uphold, my chosen one in whom I delight. I will put my spirit on him, and he will bring justice to the nations. He will not shout or cry out or raise his voice in the streets. A bruised reed he will not break. A smoldering wick he will not snuff out. In faithfulness he will bring forth justice. He will not falter or be discouraged till he establishes justice on earth. In his teaching the islands will put their hope. My brothers and sisters, Jesus, the model servant, never wavered in his submission and obedience to his Father. We see such a contrast between Jesus and the nation of Israel, whose disobedience and rebellion brought forth sorrow to the heart of God. And I think we can say that what a contrast that is to us as well. How can we possibly delight or please the Son of God when we fail to serve as Jesus served? What should be our attitude, my brothers and sisters, towards service? As individuals who have been baptized into Jesus' death and resurrection, as citizens of his kingdom, what should our attitude be towards service? We need to have the response that we find in Isaiah 6, verse 8. Then I heard the voice of the Lord saying, "Whom shall I send? And who will go for us?" And I said, "Here I am. Send me." We need to have what I call the Samuel and Mary response. Y'all familiar with the story of Samuel and Eli? They go to sleep, and two times before Eli realizes what's going on, but Samuel keeps hearing from the Lord, and he keeps going back to Eli, and Eli says, "No, I didn't call you. And then the third time, when Eli sends Samuel back, he says to Samuel, "Tell the Lord, whoever's speaking to you, he believes it's God, here I am. Speak, your servant is listening." That needs to be our attitude, my brothers and sisters, when it comes to serving our God and serving within the kingdom, serving as citizens of the kingdom of God. We need to have the attitude of, "Speak, Lord, your servant is listening." Then I look at the story of Mary of Nazareth. It says, "The angel answered, 'The Holy Spirit will come on you, and the power of the Most High will overshadow you. So the Holy One to be born will be called the Son of God. Even Elizabeth, your relative, is going to have a child in her old age, and she who is said to be unable to conceive is in her sixth month, for no word from God will ever fail.' 'I am the Lord's servant,' Mary answered. 'May your word be to me fulfilled.' And then the angel left her." Brothers and sisters, both Mary and Samuel responded to God with submission and obedience. They served God through their submission and obedience. Now, it wasn't convenient for Mary. God broke into Mary's life and pretty much turned her life upside down. Here's the scene. She and Joseph are preparing to be married. They're anticipating starting a life together and starting a family. And then God breaks in. Gabriel shows up, and he tells Mary that she's going to be the mother of the Messiah. You know, when God shows up, when an angel shows up and speaks to you, I guarantee you your life will never be the same after that. Amen? It wasn't for Mary. Her life was never the same. Her life and Joseph's lives together was never the same after that, brothers and sisters. It was not easy for her. It was not easy for them. But she responded, "Behold, the servant of the Lord." She said yes to God. Now, Mary didn't know all that was going to happen. She didn't know what it meant to fully grasp all that was going to transpire in their lives. But she knew she needed to say yes to God, and she said yes to God because she was his servant. What must be our attitude, my brothers and sisters, about service? Following the example of Jesus, our model of servanthood, it is submission and obedience. Say amen. Say it with me now. Submission and obedience. Say it together. Submission and obedience. Submission and obedience. It's not easy. It's not always convenient, nor necessarily pleasant. Whenever you think God is speaking to you, let "Yes, God, I will go, I will serve" rise instinctively within your hearts. But you know, a lot of us do this. I'm guilty of this too. We claim that we are followers of Jesus and that we love Jesus, but we have this default button, which is, "No, God, I can't serve there or do that." Or, "God, you need to send somebody else It's not convenient for me, God. We see that. We see that in ourselves. You know, we're not from northeastern Indiana. We're originally from East Chicago, Indiana. We're from the region. We lived in the hood. Amen. Amen. I was a white boy that grew up in the suburbs. And I met and married a Latina. And I moved into the inner city. It was a wonderful experience. It was an eye-opening experience. And we loved it there. And then one day, I got a call from the bishop. You know, when the bishop calls, you always know something's up. So the bishop called, and he said, "Father Rick," I said, "Yes, bishop." He says, "I got two churches that I need a priest for, and I want you to pray about taking one of them." I got real quiet on the phone. I said, "Bishop, where are the churches at?" He said, "Well, one of them's in Ohio." And I said, "Well," I'm thinking to myself, "Lord, I can never become a Buckeye." Hope I didn't offend anybody from Ohio. He said, "Well, the one in Ohio, they're good people. They got a building, and they can pay you a decent salary and so forth." And I thought, "Oh, that sounds better." But it still didn't, it wasn't clicking in my spirit. And he said, "The other church is in Huntington, Indiana." I said, "Well, Bishop, tell me about that church." And he said, "Well, they don't have a building. They can't pay you anything. There's about 12 of them. They own an altar. But that's it." He said, "I want you to pray about that." So we prayed. We prayed. The whole time I'm thinking, I ain't going nowhere. I'm not going to Ohio. And God forbid that I go to northeastern Indiana to a little place called Huntington. I ain't going. But I was nice, right? I was responding, just watching the time here. I was responsive because, you know, you gotta be, you know, when the bishop calls, you just can't tell him, "No, I ain't doing that." So we prayed. And I have to admit, brothers and sisters, I was a lot like the prophet Jonah. I ran. I did not want to go. I didn't want to go. I was content. I was comfortable. I liked where I was serving. I liked the people I was ministering to. We had our own little church. We had a nice little house. In fact, the house that we lived in was the house that my wife, as a little girl, wanted to own when she grew up. And when she grew up, we bought that house. We liked the life that we had. It was comfortable. It was comfortable. And so I ran. And I came up with all kinds of excuses. "Well, we can't go because of this and this and this and this." And the bishop would call every couple of weeks, "Father Rick, what are you thinking?" And he said, "I want you to go down and visit." We'd come down and visit the people. Nice people. But I wasn't moving. The church started praying. They started praying because they wanted me to be their priest. And I love them. They're nice folks, but I didn't want to be their priest. So they prayed. Now, I wasn't swallowed by a large fish and spit up on the shores of northeastern Indiana, but I did finally submit and was obedient to God. We sold the house, quit our jobs, packed up the kids, and we moved. And we came down to northeastern Indiana. And we've been here for quite a few years now. And we've been blessed. Brothers and sisters, responding to the call of Jesus in our lives is not always convenient, nor is it always comfortable. It's not always a pleasant experience, but God will always bless us as we walk in obedience, as we respond to his invitation, his call to serve wherever he calls us to serve, in whatever direction he calls us to go in. God will bless us. God will fill us. God will take care of us. You know, when we moved down here, I didn't have a job. My wife didn't have a job. We lived off our savings because the church couldn't pay us anything. There was just a dozen people. But God opened the doors. And God provided for us. And God has blessed us all these so many years with a wonderful church family, with good friends, good paying jobs, benefits. God will not be outdone. Y'all hear me? Say amen. Say amen. There we go. God will not be outdone. Y'all hear me now, brothers and sisters. God will not be outdone. We need to say yes to God when he calls us to serve. We need to say yes to God when he calls us to go in a certain direction. We need to say yes to God when he says, I want you to minister to these people over here. But Lord, I don't want to minister to those people over there. I remember when I started, and we'll talk more about this on Thursday, how we can serve and where we can serve. But when God called me after I finished my master's degree to go work in the inner city, at a community mental health center with gang members. I was a white kid from the suburbs. I didn't know nothing about gang members. And God called me to minister to those young men, and they taught me. They became my teacher, and they taught me about how to really to listen to those that God calls us to serve. Brothers and sisters, we need to go where God sends us. We need to go where God calls us to go. And we don't need to be afraid of it, because you know what? God goes ahead of you and I. God will provide us. God will lead us. But we need to surrender to God and allow God to use us in the way that God wants to use us. And as citizens, as I mentioned earlier, as citizens of the kingdom of God, as people who have been baptized into Christ Jesus, we are called to serve. And we need to serve where God calls us to serve. We need to look not for the fancy, shiny places, but we need to think and look about and go to the places where God wants us to go, that maybe it doesn't look so hot and it doesn't look so good. Well, I don't want to minister to those people. You know what? I have found in my life the times that I said no to God or the things I didn't want to do were the things that God wanted me to do. And I became filled and happy and content as I served where God wanted me to serve and minister to those that God wanted me to minister to. I want to share with you now a story about Dr. Martin Luther King, one of my heroes. On February 4th, 1968, Martin Luther King Jr. delivered his last sermon at Ebenezer Baptist Church titled The Drum Major Instinct. The sermon was inspired by Mark 10:43. Whoever wants to become great among you must be your servant. Dr. King, inspired from this passage, said, if you want to be important, wonderful. If you want to be recognized, wonderful. If you want to be great, wonderful. But he recognized that he who is greatest among you shall be your servant. That's a new definition of greatness. And this morning, the thing that I like about it, by giving that definition of greatness, it means that everybody can be great, because everybody can serve. You don't have to have a college degree to serve. You don't have to make your subject and your verb agree to serve. You don't have to know about Plato and Aristotle to serve. You don't have to know Einstein's theory of relativity to serve. You don't have to know the second theory of thermodynamics and physics to serve. You only need a heart full of grace, a soul generated by love, and you can be that servant. Amen. Would you all please stand? I want to pray for you all this morning. So would you please stand? Father God, we come before you in the holy and mighty name of Jesus. Father God, we ask you to pour out upon us your most Holy Spirit. That you fill us, that you empower us, that you anoint us, that we will go forth and do as you direct us to do, that we will go forth guided by you, ministering to the least, the lost, to the lonely, giving of ourselves, not counting the cost, not worrying about where or when or how, but that we'll just keep our eyes on you as you call us and lead us to serve, as you call us to make a difference in the world in which we live, to make a difference in the lives, in the hearts, in the minds of the people that we will encounter, that we'll love them and serve them as Jesus loved them and served them and continues to love them and serve them. Fill us, Holy Spirit. We can't do it on our own. We need your power to do the work of the kingdom. May we never become so comfortable and so complacent that we don't respond to the needs of the poor and the homeless and the hungry and the addicted, to the single mothers, to the elderly and the nursing homes. Use us. May we be your hands and your feet. And we pray this in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. Thank you all.